Its 30-millimeter seven-barreled cannon is the most powerful gun ever to take to the skies. It carries enough weaponry to disable 16 battle tanks. The A-10 is a legend among the soldiers it protects on the ground. So take a flight over the battlefield with the A-10 Tank Buster, now on Modern Marvels. Throughout Operation Iraqi Freedom, the A-10 Warthog was the most well-known and feared plane in the U.S. Air Force.
I think it was the best equipped Air Force and Army rated fight that we could have.
Its ability to work in close support with ground troops, to take out enemy positions and tanks, and to act as a spotter plane made it a linchpin in the victory over Saddam Hussein and his regime.
We're kind of like the insurance guy up there, or the 911 force. When they need help, they call. And that's who they expect to be there.
But for the vision of a handful of men, this aircraft was almost never built. In World War I, aircraft were used as a way of supporting the troops on the ground. In facing down resistance, the planes were called in to either bomb or wipe out the enemy.
Close support in cases of mobile warfare, of moving fronts, of fast-moving combat, whether it was retreat or advance, close support was overwhelmingly important. In those situations of battlefield chaos, it's very hard to get good artillery support. Suddenly, airplanes become overwhelmingly important and overwhelmingly effective.
During the Second World War, fighter bombers such as the Typhoon, the Tempest, the Mustang, and the Thunderbolt I were used in close air support roles very effectively. But one single aircraft was feared as the ultimate close air support machine. The German Junkers 87 dive bomber, nicknamed the Stuka, and fitted with a screaming siren, it demonstrated the most effective use of close air support ever seen.
This was a time when the Germans were enormously outnumbered by the Russians, and yet having extraordinary successes against very heavy, huge Russian tank forces. And a key component of that were these Stukas, of which the most famous unit was led by Colonel Rudel, who was the most decorated pilot of World War II.
Colonel Hans-Ulrich Rudel's unit wreaked havoc on the Russian front, with Rudel himself destroying 511 Russian tanks. But with the defeat of Germany in 1945, the success of close air support was largely overlooked. On September 18, 1947, the United States Air Force was born. Its main focus, to deliver nuclear weapons. Close air support was not a priority.
This is the extraordinary part of the whole genesis of the A-10. The Air Force, traditionally, from the beginnings of World War II on, had no interest in close support, have none today. They don't like working for the Army, that they prefer running their own war totally independent of everybody else. A very natural bureaucratic reaction.
During the Vietnam War, the Air Force had to rely on aircraft such as the A-1 Sky Raider to protect its ground forces. But what was clearly needed was an aircraft specifically designed to carry large bomb loads, absorb heavy ground fire, and fly for long periods at low altitude over the battleground. Taking the initiative, a group of highly skilled engineers at the Pentagon came up with the specifications for a close air support aircraft with the hope that the Air Force would eventually see the light.
We designed the airplane based on the close support done by these A-1 pilots. We used the experience of the Germans on the Russian front with Stukas, and we actually interviewed Colonel Rudel, who was still alive at the time. We used his experience very heavily in the design of the airplane. We tried to shape an airplane that was directly useful in specifically support of Army troops in the field.
A first in aviation history, the Air Force eventually initiated a competition for an aircraft to be specifically designed for close air support.
When the request for the proposal on the A-10 came in, I immediately was assigned to work on the aerodynamics of that. Fundamentally, she was to be a close air support airplane, which was capable of knocking out heavy tanks, as well as operating from an unprepared short field of 1,500 feet.
Fairchild Republic took on the challenges of designing an aircraft unlike any ever built. The winning design would be a stable, straight-winged aircraft to allow for excellent lift and maneuverability. This, combined with the General Electric's TF-34 turbofan engines, which would give it a high thrust for takeoff, and a low fuel consumption to enable the plane to have loiter capabilities essential for the role. With unbeatable durability and an easy-to-repair maintenance program, these were the ideal engines designed to fly in a hostile battle zone. But for the Fairchild team, the challenges became apparent immediately.
The typical way to build a jet airplane, and the reason that all jet fighters are impossible to use in this close support mission, because they all have fuel wrapped around the engine. Once you have fuel wrapped around an engine, a .22 rifle will kill you. One of our very first design rules was the fuel had to be someplace other than the engine.
Not only was the fuel safely stored in the fuselage away from the engines, the fuel tanks also had unique built-in fire suppression capabilities. The aircraft's hydraulics could also withstand serious firepower.
We required that every hydraulic control had to be backed up by a simple mechanical cable system that's much harder to shoot out.
We could come back with hydraulic system shot out, half the tail shot off, a piece of the wing shot off. Had two engines, you could come home on one. The pilot was bathed in a titanium tub, which could take 20 millimeter shells. It was really a piece of machinery that you could fly into hell and back.
The A-10's survivability was matched with a deadly capacity, a huge 30-millimeter Gatling gun. Developed specifically for the A-10, the GAU-8 A-Avenger was capable of firing almost 4,000 rounds a minute, giving the aircraft the ability to blow through tank armor.
She was designed primarily with a Gatling gun on the nose, and it was built to destroy anything that was considered an armored weapon on the ground. But she was built around the gun, and the gun was a given from day one.
Fairchild Republic wins the competition to build the first aircraft in U.S. aviation history specifically designed for close air support. But before the Air Force will give the go-ahead, they want hard evidence that the aircraft and the gun can perform well together. The need would spark a series of simulation tests unlike any ever produced. Little did its designers realize, these tests would change the future of aviation history. The A-10 has a false canopy painted on the bottom side of its fuselage. This is done to confuse the pilots of enemy planes during air-to-air combat. Modern models will return in a moment. After a heated competition, Fairchild Republic has produced the ultimate piece of machinery to perform the role of close air support. But the Air Force was reluctant to go into production until they have seen for themselves that the aircraft can fulfill its very specific combat role. In a series of amazing tests, the A-10 and its remarkable gun are put through their paces in an effort to create a full-on Cold War battle scenario.
We had secretly assembled what we proudly boasted at the time was like the third or fourth largest tank army in the world. Over 300 Soviet tanks from all over the world, off junk heaps and whatever, out in the desert outside Las Vegas. So we ran a program with A-10s, with a gun installed, and with the current ammunition as it was going into production.
She had a very strange sound to those engines, very characteristic, and to this day, every time I hear it, I look up, because I know it's my bird. We knew what she'd do. And she didn't disappoint us.
And we did a meticulous series of tests, attack after attack, checking tactics, checking burst lengths, all these details to see how effective we were against tanks. We learned an enormous amount about it. The most important thing we learned was that this weapon had unprecedented effectiveness.
During the Cold War, the threat of Soviet tanks advancing on Western Europe was at times a very real possibility. The Air Force finally gives the production of the A-10 the go-ahead. It was now ready to face a specific enemy. With its highly accurate weapons delivery platform, it was the ideal machine to defend against Soviet armored supremacy. The first A-10 arrived at Davis-Monthan Air Force Base in Arizona in October 1975. Immediately christened the Warthog, the A-10 was admired for its simplicity and ruggedness rather than its good looks.
It's kind of an ugly only a mother could love is probably the way most of us describe it. It's that ugliness is what makes it so tough.
It's very rugged. People can compare it to like a Jeep or a Hummer or something like that. It's thick, it's big, everything about it is boxy, and it looks very strong and sturdy. It's almost guaranteed to bring the pilot back alive.
But with a top speed of only 420 miles per hour, high set twin engines, and squared off slab-like wings, the A-10 was a far cry from any streamlined jet.
It's pretty awe-inspiring. It was so much bigger than the aircraft I'd flown in pilot training. Just, it felt huge and it felt big getting into it. And it was also intimidating just because first time you fly the airplane, you're by yourself, but it was definitely exhilarating at the same time.
The single-seat cockpit is surrounded by a large bubble canopy to provide all-around vision and a bulletproof windscreen.
I love single-seat cockpit. That's one of the reasons that I was enticed by the A-10. No one looking over your shoulder. No one telling you what to do. You put the aircraft where you want to do it, and you employ it in the fashion that you want to employ it. It's all personal, and you are the master.
I think the first time that was one of the things that surprised me. It took itself right off the runway for the most part. Once it hits the speed it wants to fly, it just lifts up and away. And I think it probably has to do a lot with the big straight wing, positive camber on the wing. It wants to fly.
The plane reacts to you. It's like you kind of strap on the plane itself, and it's an extension of you. And it flies. It has a feel of a real stick and rudder. The A-10 is known for its tight turn radius, so it can turn on a dime. You can even look at the ground as you're turning, and it looks like you're just turning in space.
Straight wing lets us turn very, very tight. So even though we're going slow, we've got a very small turn radius, and we can very quickly move our flight path so that we can dodge all those, the AAA and the surface-to-air missiles.
But it's the challenge of the unique close air support role that's the main attraction to the A-10 pilots. It's an environment where anything can happen at any time.
The mission that we do is not a rote mission. You don't come into it knowing exactly every single thing that's going to happen from the time you take off to the time you land. Once you get in the air is where it starts actually unfolding, and you have to react to that.
You hear American voices on the radio screaming because they're taking fire and that there are people dying. Their artillery can't get the enemy. They call in the attends.
Flying of the airplane has to become secondary. Now you're trying to employ the weapon system, and that's where it gets complicated. We get maps spread out in the cockpit, and we're still trying to talk on the radios and keep from getting shot at. You know, we consider ourselves the last gunfighter that's really out there, because when you go into battle and it's a close-in CAS fight, the number one weapon of choice of an A-10 pilot is going to be their gun.
The weapons delivery system incorporates a heads-up display, or HUD, that provides the pilot with the references for flight control and weapons employment.
It's incredibly accurate for a gun system, and probably one of the most flexible weapon systems in the world. It's just point and shoot, just like you'd imagine a revolver in your hand. You point it where you want to shoot it, you pull the trigger, and that's where the bullets are going to go.
When you roll in and you pull the trigger for the first time, you get excited and the adrenaline starts pumping through, and I had the biggest smile on my face.
What a feeling shooting the gun. I mean, the whole airplane shakes. The first time I fired the gun, you know, I had to come off the trigger because it scared me, because I couldn't believe something like that could come out of the front of the airplane, all the flames, the smoke. This 30 millimeter bullet is the size of my forearm, and that smell of gunpowder, you get that in the cockpit after you fire the gun, and it's just incredible. You get a little bit of a high from it, I think, sometimes. It smells like victory.
But it would be some time before the pilots would use their guns in anger. With the ending of the Cold War, the tank fleets of the Warsaw Pact no longer seemed like a threat. And the U.S. Air Force plans to withdraw the A-10 fleet from service by the 1990s. But with a serious situation brewing in the Middle East, all that is about to change. The Warthog was about to play a key role in bringing down one of the most destructive individuals in history. Fuel for the A-10 is held in a self-sealing compartment that's protected by internal and external foam. This holding cell will automatically repair itself if hit by a bullet of up to 23 millimeters in size. Modern Marvels will return in a moment. In September 1980, Iraq invades Iran, beginning one of the longest and most destructive wars of the 20th century. After 8 years, the basic issues dividing the countries remain unresolved. In an effort to contain the Ayatollah Khomeini and the spread of Islamic fundamentalism, the West backed Iraq. Saddam Hussein, the Iraqi dictator, built a formidable war machine, bolstered by the Soviets and the West. Becoming the fourth largest army in the world, with over 4,000 tanks. On August 2, 1990, Iraq invaded Kuwait. For 15 years, the A-10 waited for the chance to justify its place in the Air Force's arsenal. For the Warthog, it's now make or break time.
When the first Gulf War started and our squadron deployed down there, approaching that time period, the Air Force was considering getting rid of the airplane. It wasn't until the Gulf War came around that we proved the fact that we are a capable CAS platform.
When the war broke out on January 16, 1991, there was an urgent need for a missile-launching tank buster. The A-10s were committed to combat for the very first time.
Back then, you know, we had nobody with combat experience except for a few of the very senior leadership that had flown in Vietnam. So a lot of people were unsure what to expect.
Deployed to the Gulf to back up coalition ground forces, A-10 squadrons launched on Iraq's thousands of tanks in the mother of all battles.
First day, I'll never forget that feeling. It was like, wow, this is the big game. You know, you're all pumped up, adrenaline's flowing. You know, let's go. You know, you go in, we hit a target, and I remember looking down and going, what's all that glittery stuff down there? And sure enough, it was, you know, them shooting. Whoa, they're shooting at us. And that's when it kind of hit you, you know, this isn't just training anymore.
The way that I saw the Iraqis working is, if they knew we were going to hit something, they moved it. And they played lots of shell games. And it's kind of like a, you know, where are they hiding it now?
By February, the coalition air forces appear to be dominating the skies, and the A-10 is seemingly invincible.
And we're feeling pretty confident. You know, if you survive your first 10 combat missions, your chances of surviving the war are pretty, go up significantly.
Major Rob Sweet was on his 30th mission for Desert Storm. On February 15th, he was the wingman in a two-ship mission launched deep into Iraqi airspace.
It was a little far into bad guy land for an A-10. It was about 100 miles past the border where good guys were. And my flight lead, who was obviously a lot more experienced and wiser than I was a little concerned about the mission.
With Iraqis' ammunition running low, Saddam's forces were being more selective about their targets and sought to maintain a higher strike rate.
So we said, all right, well, we won't hang out as much, and the target will take 2-3 passes, and then we'll leave, go somewhere else. There's a formation of tanks in a circle about 3 miles in diameter, no craters anywhere, and we were kind of aware that maybe these were plywood dummy targets.
Sweet's flight leader rolled in to take a closer look at the target, and then clears his wingman in. For Sweet, what began as a routine mission was about to turn into his worst nightmare.
As I'm coming off, sure enough, here comes Sam. Well, whoa, that ain't good. But if you see it, you can beat it. So I saw it, put out some chaff flare, I kind of pulled around it, and it missed, sure enough. But a guy who was close. In fact, that is the closest I'd ever been come to getting hit by anything. So I went from being, whoa, that scared the living daylights out of me, to losing my professionalism somewhat and getting really pissed off at this guy for scaring me. So he was going to die for doing that. As I was rolling in, you know, I felt a loud bang in the airplane, and I went, ooh, that isn't good. And I looked back, and I didn't like what I saw. Most of my right wing was gone, it was on fire. Thinking to myself, okay, bad hit, but there's still some wing on there, and I should be able to fly it out of there, and the A-10's pretty rugged.
The Iraqi missile, which would have destroyed most other fighters, seriously cripples the A-10.
The plane enters a steep spin slash spiral, starts spiraling on down. I'm throwing switches trying to recover. I'm yelling, yeah, I can't recover. And then I start to panic. And I remember just seeing a desert coming up like this. Time to get out.
The ACES II ejection seat is a fully automatic catapult rocket system. Once ejected, the parachute automatically deploys.
Coming down on my parachute, now I see my A-10 hit the ground. And that was kind of disturbing.
As Sweet hits the ground, he's seized by Iraqi soldiers.
You know, they were on me before I even had a chance to roll over. And then it was their chance to get some payback. And so I got the crap beat out of me, basically.
He's taken away to a command bunker and interrogated.
I thought I was going to get shot at any moment, you know. It took me about 3 days to figure out, hey, they weren't going to just arbitrarily execute me. It was worth something to them, propaganda or intelligence or something.
In March, Major Rob Sweet is eventually released as part of the prisoner release program.
This is when I found out what happened to my flight lead. After I had been shot down, my flight lead had been shot down. And it turns out he never got out.
Lucky to be alive, he spent 4 months recovering from his ordeal.
If I would have been flying any other fighter when I was hit by the SAM, and it was a bad hit, I'd be dead right now.
But despite this, the aircraft proves more versatile and better able to survive over enemy territory than anyone expects. During the 40-day conflict, the A-10 force destroys 987 tanks, 926 artillery pieces, 1,355 combat vehicles, 10 fighters on the ground, and 2 helicopters shot in air-to-air engagements. The A-10 earned a new nickname, the Tank Buster. The result confounds all those who questioned the need for a dedicated ground support aircraft. Flying a staggering 8,500 missions, A-10s are responsible for more than half of Iraq's losses of military equipment in Operation Desert Storm. Tragically, this remarkable record is marred by a number of incidents in which coalition forces are mistakenly attacked by A-10s.
Now, there was an incident yesterday in which an American A-10 inadvertently fired on 2 of our infantry fighting vehicles. The aircraft was one of several which had been called in to deal with an enemy position, and the incident itself is, of course, under investigation.
9 British soldiers were killed. The Air Force was adamant that it could eliminate attacks from friendly fire. What nobody knows is that the next challenge for the A-10 will be in an entirely new and forbidding battlefield, Afghanistan. 721 A-10 aircraft were built since 1975. 367 are in active service today. Modern Marvels will return in a moment. The A-10 proved itself a success in Desert Storm. But for this aging aircraft to remain integral to the Air Force attack plan, it would have to meet the constraints of an ever-changing battlefield.
The A-10 got quite a few upgrades. No new engines or anything like that, but more avionics upgrades. We were able to incorporate systems that had come online, the global positioning satellite systems. The A-10 was the first fighter to fully integrate with the night vision devices. The whole cockpit is modified to use night vision goggles. We've been training with them longer than pretty much any other fighter community, and we've gotten very good at it.
The A-10 is destined for a new mission. On September 11th, 2001, the war on terrorism begins.
Our response involves far more than instant retaliation and isolated strikes. Americans should not expect one battle, but a lengthy campaign, unlike any other we have ever seen.
The Warthog strengthens Operation Enduring Freedom, spearheading urgently needed around-the-clock cover for ground troops in Afghanistan. For the crews of the A-10s, it was like nothing they had ever seen.
We arrived in Bagram, reported to my commander, and I said, "Boss, this has got to be the scariest place on earth." You really felt like you were in the middle of a combat zone, and we were.
The A-10 is the ideal aircraft for the Afghanistan battlefield. The jet is versatile enough to navigate mountainous peaks and deep valleys, while also patrolling and pinpoint attacking their targets.
It wasn't bad flying over the mountainous terrain. The bad part was if I ever had to get out of the airplane, there's a lot of snow down there. That's not a good place to be. Going from a nice warm cockpit down into the snow is not an idea that I want to have to fulfill. The airplane, higher altitudes than what we normally would fly just because of the heights of the mountains over there. We were able to go places that the other fixed wing assets may or may not have been able to get in very well. And we definitely went places that the helicopters couldn't get in.
Around the clock, the Warthogs support regular and special forces soldiers while combing the mountains of Afghanistan for enemy rocket launch sites and mortar posts. As its pilots soon realized, every mission would test their training and their wills to the limit.
We showed up just past dark and got a brief, was handed a set of maps, and was told, hey, there's a lot of ground guys who are in trouble. Go out there and do what you do. Didn't have a whole lot of situational awareness on what was going on the ground. And when we checked in, the radios were just going crazy with guys calling for close air support.
Your pulse rate goes up. The intensity of what you're thinking about goes up. You know, the adrenaline rush, it's a good feeling though. And what's nice is you turn your airplane towards the fight and your training takes over.
So first thing we're looking for is what's the overall situation on the ground and get a big picture view and then move into the area. And once we get into the area, have a pretty good idea of where everybody should be, now we'll move from the big picture to the much smaller concentrated area. And one of the first things I'm going to try to do is look down and try to find where the friendly position is. And if I can't identify him exactly, I want to at least narrow down something that I can use as a line in the sand and say, okay, we can't drop past here, because that's where our guys are.
On entering the battle zone, one of the A-10 pilot's main responsibilities is to avoid friendly fire incidents at all costs.
What we mainly have to help us avoid fratricide is our radios and our eyes. Very low tech, but I think that's what makes us more efficient. Yes, we have a global positioning system that helps us figure out where we are. And we have night vision goggles that find out what's down there. But when it comes time to find out where the target is, yeah, we got to use old-fashioned Mark I eyeballs and our hands to think about where that is, because without that, we couldn't do our mission.
We went in there, and the night vision goggles were really hard to use because the sun had set, but it wasn't low enough where we were getting a lot of brightness coming from the west. So it was really difficult to use the NVGs. There was no moon illumination, and we're in this very harsh terrain that I've never seen before.
A team of observers down on the battlefield work with each pilot to guide the aircraft to its target. The Terminal Attack Controller, or ETAC, works for the Army and is responsible for ensuring that the A-10 pilot identifies and attacks the correct target while minimizing the risk to friendly ground forces.
We pass them a situational update, an area update on what's going on in the battlefield. Let them know where the friendly troops are, what the situation is of the enemy. And they kind of give them a heads up of what the threats are in the area. We'll pass them all that information. They'll copy it down. They work their little magic in the cockpit.
The A-10 is linked to the ground commanders by an Army radio network, which distributes data throughout the battlefield.
He said, hey, here's where we are, and I need you to put some ordnance down 700 meters from us, which that was eye-opening. And so we took that distance and rolled in and put a couple 500-pound bombs down, and it immediately quieted the target area.
It's kind of like a large dragon breathing fire. That's what I can see. You know, it sounds really loud, like a dinosaur, really, raining lead from the sky.
Like guardian angels, A-10s continue to fly over Afghanistan, protecting their friends on the ground until the war against terrorism ends. But an old enemy was waiting in the wings.
States like these and their terrorist allies constitute an axis of evil, arming to threaten the peace of the world.
The need for the A-10 would reach its climax in March 2003. Saddam Hussein's horrific regime is reaching fever pitch. This time, it would take an army with the A-10 on the front lines to bring him down. An A-10 fighter is still capable of flying with 10 feet of its wing missing and half of its tail gone. Modern marvels will return in a moment. March 2003. Saddam Hussein's forces are about to come head to head with the A-10 tank buster. as it once again prepares to fly over the battlefields of Iraq. The coalition forces mean to end the regime of Saddam Hussein for good. The Warthog has come a long way since the last desert battle.
By the time the second Gulf War, the Iraqi Freedom comes along, pretty much every airplane had been modified to improve the weapon's accuracy.
The AGM-65 Maverick missiles are highly accurate, carrying warheads specifically for targeting heavy armor. Infrared imaging guidance enabled them to shoot moving targets at night. Combine these with the already large weapons load and the special laser targeting pods, and the Warthog is better prepared than ever for its deadly role in Iraq. Flying from the seized Talil Air Base in southern Iraq, A-10s fly numerous missions as coalition forces launch one of the greatest military assaults since World War II. The assault of Baghdad. For the A-10 crews, it would be the challenge of a lifetime.
We're flying up towards Baghdad. We're excited to go up there, but the hair on the back of our necks was standing up, and your heart was beating really fast. I actually said a lot more prayers stepping into the cockpit that day.
There's all those different emotions running through your mind, and you're saying, please, you know, let me do what I'm trying to do and do the right thing.
Calling the Warthogs to their targets is another essential member of the ground command team, the Forward Air Controller, or FAC. A-10 pilots take turns to carry out this job, using their specialist knowledge of the mission in the air to coordinate with the soldiers on the ground.
We go to a battalion, and we speak Air Force to the Army. We make sure the no fratricide occurs. Air Force doesn't shoot the Army, Army doesn't shoot the Air Force. Keep them deconflicted, but then secondary to that is make sure that those A-10s affect the battlefield for the Army.
Everyone's talking, just trying to get permission to actually execute the attack. And those sound like simple questions, and this sounds like, you know, pick up the phone, ask, but when you're asking one airplane who's relaying to another guy who's probably, you know, 400 or 500 miles away sitting in a room somewhere, it takes time. And, oh, by the way, every aggressive fighter pilot in Iraq at this point is making the same phone call, trying to get permission.
Thanks for the work, sir. I got your lead.
The FAC is the A-10 pilot's first point of contact on arrival in the area. Part of his role is to provide the pilot with the target coordinates with pinpoint accuracy.
It sounds cold-hearted, but it's very systematic, you know. They tell us the targets, we find the targets, we kill them, we report it's killed, next target. And it just goes, next target, next target.
On arrival over the battlefield, the A-10 pilot often has to use basic technology to locate exactly where the target is. In pilot Eric Yehemowitz's case, an Iraqi missile site.
I went down with the binoculars and was searching the target coordinates. The six missile launchers weren't where they were supposed to be. So it took me a little while to search the area. The Iraqis had moved them probably about half a mile to a mile away. You know, I'm thinking to myself, okay, I don't know if that radar operator sees me with that missile, and but I see the target next to it, and it was just an awesome feeling.
Your focus then all of a sudden is into this one little area is what you're looking at. As you roll down, pilots call it the chute, or when you roll in to employ, that's it, the whole world melts into just this little area.
And I was able to lock this thing up and fired that missile, and it came screaming off the rail.
From over 17,000 feet, the long-range 300-pound launch-and-leave Maverick missile travels to its target. For Yehemowitz, the seconds seem to go on forever.
I'm waiting and I'm thinking, oh man, the missile went stupid. You know, it went flying into Iran. It should have hit by now. And I'm like, oh man, I'm in trouble. It just felt like an eternity.
It is surreal. You're so far up, it's hard to hear anything on the ground. You're so used to hearing the jet. It's like the white noise of having a fan in the background.
But then all of a sudden, boom, I mean, it's a massive explosion. And it is totally elation. Now I know I got him.
You pull off, get a little more altitude, and then turn back and take a look. And it's a little fire show for you.
It's just so professional, it's unbelievable. There's not a lot of hooting and hollering, and you know, it's not like Top Gun, people screaming, yeehaw. I mean, it's war and people are dying and everyone knows it. You know, we're sitting on the edge of our seats concentrating that we don't get shot down for once and then that we don't hurt the wrong people.
Going in there, I said I have two objectives. One, zero fratricide, two, affect the battlefield. And they were in that order. My number one goal was to prevent fratricide.
Knowing where the friendly forces are is paramount if the A-10s are to protect them. And losing sight of troops on the ground can lead to mistakes or deadly friendly fire.
As a fighter pilot, that's our first job to find out, is there anyone out here that we don't know about? You know, it comes down to a fight with friendlies nearby. Weapons release is going to be authorized by the guy on the ground. So you have to have that warm fuzzy that you've got the complete picture, that you know these are friendly troops, those are enemy troops.
But even with all the advantages of modern technology, relying on this alone can seriously jeopardize the troops on the ground.
Yes, there are technological ways. There are also old school ways, giving a good talk on, making sure you're confirming with that aircraft that he really does see the friendlies. There's a thousand ways to make sure that he's looking at the right thing and you all are on the same page of music. And I used every single one of them because I'd rather drop zero bombs and have zero fratricide than drop 1,000 bombs and have one be on a friendly position.
Despite the fear of horrific friendly fire accidents, the feeling of flying the plane is the love of every Hawg driver and the reason for signing up.
It's no race car, you know, it's not the Porsche, you know, it's not even a pickup truck. In such a neat airplane, because I feel like I'm flying with the seat of my pants, I can feel everything that's happening to the airplane. None of it's magic, it's all me. Whatever it does, I made it do.
The 60 Warthogs deployed for Iraqi freedom dominate the skies, firing an incredible 311,597 rounds of 30-millimeter ammunition. The flying gun performs amazingly.
We lost a few pokes in the first Gulf War. We didn't lose any in the second. Lost airplanes, but we didn't lose people. That's a testament to the aircraft itself. If I had to be in an airplane and be shot at, the A-10 is the only one I want to be in.
The A-10 is an awesome airframe, and the fact that it works with you and it feels like it's a part of you, and it's one of the only airframes left that it's true flying. You can feel it fly.
The A-10 means close air support at its finest. It's been my home now for 8 years, and I love it, and I hope I get to stick with it, and I hope we get the upgrades we want to take us into this next century and keep supporting the Army. But I think it's just an awesome weapons platform. It fills a specific niche, and it does it really well.
Able to keep flying with battle damage that would cripple many other designs and lethal to any armored vehicle in service, the humble Warthog of the 1970s has come to rule supreme over the digital battlefields of the 21st century. Due to remain in service until at least 2025, the A-10 Warthog has proven itself to be one of the most effective aircraft ever flown in the U.S. Air Force and a legend to those who've flown it.
She is not very clean when it comes to protuberances and bumps and... So she's not the sleekest looking piece of machinery that I ever designed. But she got the job done.
September 18th, 1947, the United States Air Force was born. Its main focus, to deliver nuclear weapons. Close air support was not a priority.
This is the extraordinary part of the whole genesis of the A-10. The Air Force, traditionally, from the beginnings of World War II on, had no interest in close support, have none today. They don't like working for the Army, that they prefer running their own war totally independent of everybody else. A very natural bureaucratic reaction.
During the Vietnam War, the Air Force had to rely on aircraft such as the A-1 Skyraider to protect its ground forces. But what was clearly needed was an aircraft specifically designed to carry large bomb loads, absorb heavy ground fire, and fly for long periods at low altitude over the battleground. Taking the initiative, a group of highly skilled engineers at the Pentagon came up with the specifications for a close air. But one single aircraft was feared as the ultimate close air support machine. The German Junkers 87 dive bomber, nicknamed the Stuka, and fitted with a screaming siren, it demonstrated the most effective use of close air support ever seen.
This was a time when the Germans were enormously outnumbered by the Russians and yet having extraordinary successes against very heavy, huge Russian tank forces. And a key component of that were these Stukas, of which the most famous unit was led by Colonel Rudel, who was the most decorated pilot of World War II.
Colonel Hans-Ulrich Rudel's unit wreaked havoc on the Russian front, with Rudel himself destroying 511 Russian tanks. But with the defeat of Germany in 1945, the success of close air support was largely overlooked. Its 30mm 7-barreled cannon is the most powerful gun ever to take to the skies. It carries enough weaponry to disable 16 battle tanks. The A-10 is a legend among the soldiers it protects on the ground. So take a flight over the battlefield with the A-10 Tank Buster, now on Modern Marvels. Throughout Operation Iraqi Freedom, the A-10 Warthog was the most well-known and feared plane in the U.S. Air Force.
I think it was the best equipped Air Force and Army rated fight that we could have.
Its ability to work in close support with ground troops, to take out enemy positions and tanks, and to act as a spotter plane made it a linchpin in the victory over Saddam Hussein and his regime.
We're kind of like the insurance guy up there, or the 911 force. When they need help, they call. And that's who they expect to be there.
But for the vision of a handful of men, this aircraft was almost never built. In World War I, aircraft were used as a way of supporting the troops on the ground. In facing down resistance, the planes were called in to either bomb or wipe out the enemy.
Close support in cases of mobile warfare, of moving fronts, of fast-moving combat, whether it was retreat or advance, close support was overwhelmingly important. In those situations of battlefield chaos, where it's very hard to get good artillery support, suddenly airplanes become overwhelmingly important and overwhelmingly effective.
During the Second World War, fighter bombers such as the Typhoon, the Tempest, the Mustang, and the Thunderbolt I were used in close air support roles very effectively. Air support aircraft, with the hope that the Air Force would eventually see the light.
We designed the airplane based on the close support done by these A-1 pilots. We used the experience of the Germans on the Russian front with Stukas. And we actually interviewed Colonel Rudel, who was still alive at the time. We used his experience very heavily in the design of the airplane. And we tried to shape an airplane that was directly useful in specifically support of Army troops in the field.
A first in aviation history, the Air Force eventually initiated a competition for an aircraft to be specifically designed for close air support.
When the request for the proposal on the A-10 came in, I immediately was assigned to work on the aerodynamics of that. Fundamentally, she was to be a close air support airplane, which was capable of knocking out heavy tanks, as well as operating from an unprepared short field of 1,500 feet.